Thank you, sir. Whenever you're ready, we're ready. Thank you through the chair while I finish my cough drop. For the benefit of new members of council, I just want to give a very quick overview of the Department of Parks, Recreation and Culture. So our mandate is to enhance quality of life for Port-au-Prince residents through a wide range of innovative, inclusive, accessible programming, providing opportunities for physical activities, social interaction, and community engagement. just a kind of an overview of the department itself. Our department is responsible for the management, maintenance, and development and construction of all community parks, neighborhood parks, waterfront areas, and trails within the municipality. We currently manage and maintain about 191 hectares of parkland and open space, including 45 parks, 14 kilometers of trails, 9 soccer pitches, 15 ball diamonds, 22 playgrounds, 5 tennis courts, 2 beaches, and park facilities like Memorial Park, the skate park, the Town Agricultural Park, Caroline Street, etc. As far as recreation facilities, we have 4 facilities that we currently maintain from a parks, recreation, and culture standpoint, that being the Jack Berger Sports Complex, the Town Park Recreation Center, the Ruth Clark Activity Center, and the Portal Community Hub, which is the former Canton Municipal Office. And as Brian had alluded to earlier, we are now responsible for the maintenance of all corporate facilities previously under corporate services and the 3 fire stations as well. And as well, we provide a number either through direct delivery or through partnerships, programs and services from a recreational perspective. These leisure programs would contribute to the health and well-being of our individuals and enhance that quality of life as stated earlier. The wide range of programming would be from seniors down to infants and include aquatics, day camp, cultural programs, general recreation programs, and a much higher focus now on cultural programming. While our staff are all Hi-Fi certified, and the municipality of Port Hope is a platinum youth-friendly community designated, so, and that's something that we'll be working on this year. Last but not least, we also maintain cemeteries. We currently maintain Port Hope Union Cemetery, St. John's, Anglican Cemetery, and as of 2017, Welcome United Church Cemetery. Those are all active cemeteries. In 2018, we also acquired Providence Cemetery, which again is an active cemetery, and that's on the 7th line. We also maintain 6 abandoned cemeteries, and that's also been added onto in 2018 with the Zion Cemetery that we now, we're going through the process of ownership, and we now maintain that as well. And of course, the waterfront harbor lands, that includes the 2 beaches, the center pier when it is finally cleaned up, in the inner basin. So that's just kind of a quick background on PRC. And I'll move into our slide presentation. And hopefully I get this right. Where do I point? Get there. So some of our 2019 initiatives is our biannual pool shutdowns. Every 2 years we drain the pools and do a number of maintenance activities that are literally very extremely difficult to do when the pools are full. So it include acid bathing the bottom of the pools, any repairs to grout work and tile, replacing sand and filters. Pool controllers are all calibrated and upgraded. And we also include activities like general repairs and painting within the change rooms and the actual pool enclosure itself. This year we are looking at one of our main, one of the big challenges we've had this year is we are looking at a complete refurbishment of the bottom of the 2 pools, so that would be the 25 meter pool and the therapy pool. We've experienced delamination in 2017 and we've got some delamination occurring at this point. So it is something that we have identified as a priority for this upcoming pool shutdown. We're also looking at purchasing a new columbarium at the cemetery. We are forecasting that the existing columbarium will be full or close to full in 2019. So again, looking at the replacement of that. And as I alluded to earlier, much stronger emphasis on cultural programming at the Port Hope Community Hub, and of course in our other facilities as well. But building on the partnership with the library at that particular location and offering some free workshops and free programs in order to garner interest with the hopes that down the road that they will become registered paid programs. Our operating budget, and again this does include the corporate facilities as I alluded to earlier, expenditures of $4.19 million, of which we do generate user fees of $1.1 million. That would be for drop-in programs, any registered recreational programs, rental of facilities, including the pools, the arena, and parks. Cemetery revenues would also be included in that. The reserves, the $247,000 in reserves, that is for the payment for the debenture for the revitalization of the sports complex. Government grants, we do as a department take as many opportunities as we can to apply for grants. The main bulk of that particular, the total $57,000 is for the Ruth Clark Activity Center. So in essence, the EPC grant, the Elderly Person Centers grant, that covers the salary of the full-time employee that is responsible for all of our older adults programming. So the total tax requirement for the levy is $2.7 million. And as stated earlier, $277,800 now for corporate facilities that we are responsible for. So some of our notable changes, revenue increases of $66,250. So we continue to see growth at the, in particular at the sports complex for our aquatics programming and our aquatic leadership programs. We also have seen a fairly significant increase in day camp participation. I believe it was, Julia's here, I believe it was around $12,000 we're projecting in increased revenues. But as well, we project out price increases in 5 years in advance. So this does account for price increases, which on average are about 3% per year. And we take that approach particularly for our user groups in order to allow them to budget accordingly long term. So for example, minor hockey or a swim club, minor ball, soccer, etc. Town Park Recreation Center, the grounds and maintenance, we reduced that by $33,000. So basically we have a pocket of money that we use for pool shutdown every 2 years. And then on the opposite year, we would use those funds at other locations as necessary. So last year we invested at the rec center with a complete refurbishment of the gym floor and some work to our HVAC equipment and some lighting. Improvements going to LED lighting, so that's now been taken off, but obviously it's been allocated to the sports complex for pool shutdown. Some increased financial requirements, staffing costs. So when it's just looking at the breakdown of staffing costs, for example, there's about $9,000 that we've accounted for a summer student for special events with a focus on Canada. Albeit that, those costs are offset by federal grants and a very successful sponsorship program that we initiated last year for Canada, which brought in quite a bit more revenue than what we had projected. In addition, as I stated earlier, the cultural programming and the free programming at the Hub, although there are increases in revenues, as spoken to earlier, that go with that. Customer service staff at the Jack Burger Sports Complex on Saturday mornings, we're looking at providing additional hours to have customer service staff available to answer inquiries and to take program registration. And in parks, a slight increase with respect to primarily step increases for those staffing costs. We did see some decreases in staffing at the sports complex as we've had a turnover of staff, long-serving staff that are retiring this year, which will certainly provide some savings from that perspective. But also, although the corporate facilities, you'll note that staffing increases, there's staffing increases That's a result of taking the former custodian position and transferring it to the sports complex and taking the existing facilities foreman position and moving it into corporate facilities. And there is obviously an increase just due to the responsibilities of that staff person, but I would note that that particular staff person still is responsible for overseeing operations for the four PRC facilities and also was looking after the three fire halls. So certainly I believe that there's a lot of efficiencies in that area. The pool maintenance, again, this is a hit of $145,000 this year and is one of the main reasons for our increase in our budget, as if it wasn't for the replacement of the bottom of those pools, we actually would have submitted a budget less than what was required last year. The reserve contribution decrease, I believe that the majority of that was last year, the $33,000 I alluded to for Town Park Recreation Center, as well as $5,000 to purchase some equipment at the sports complex. Last year, it was a decision of council to utilize capital surplus reserves to pay for those particular items. So that revenue source is now come off of our budget, so that's an impact of $37,000. As David alluded to earlier, we've increased our training and our memberships to the amount of $9,700. Again, staff turnovers and investing in our staff, but also ensuring that it's provided equitably across our department. Previously, there was some key staff that would receive that training, and others would receive it as if resources were available, and our objective would be hopefully to be able to provide that training across the board to all of our full-time staff. Contract services is primarily, the increase is primarily for IT services. We have a mesh program which we use for all of our, it's a computer program with tablets for all of our playground inspections, and we also use it for our health and safety inspections and our fire safety inspections for all of our facilities, and that would include the corporate facilities. And we also have a new scheduling software program to schedule our staff. And as you can imagine, with 17 full-time staff and any given time, 50 plus part-time staff, it can be challenging with scheduling these staff when we have operations running 7 days a week, 365. Service level recommendations, obviously there's none included in the proposed budget. We did have two that we brought forward, one being a cemetery operator. So as I stated earlier, we've assumed in the last 3 years, or 2 years, sorry, we've now assumed operation of an additional three cemeteries. We do have a person on contract who works 50 weeks a year, so they're not technically a full-time employee, and so the difference would be the up of the 2 weeks and the benefits. But that would have been an impact of $16,800. As well, we had proposed to complete our leisure services master plan. Our master plan that we currently have was completed in 2010, and we are about 95% complete of that original plan. The planning for that would take roughly a year from the time a consultant would be retained and the process undertaken, including a survey of our residents. But as a senior management team and as a department head, we felt that we could wait an additional year before that was undertaken. Capital carry forward. One item on here needs to be updated, that being the library HVAC dry cooler. That was previously included in the 2017 budget and was going to be funded through gas tax. However, through discussions with our current HVAC contractor and with some efficiencies and repairs, our staff are of the opinion that that project is no longer required. So that project will not be carried forward and those funds will be put back into the gas tax reserve and they'll be used for other projects that are identified in the capital budget this year. The Town Park entrance, that project is a total budget of $77,000, albeit that's the total cost. There's a significant fundraising campaign that's associated with that. So that $77,000 isn't actually a municipal levy charge. That program is very close to being completed. I believe we're right now we're at $68,000, including the municipal funds. So we do anticipate that that work will begin early in the spring and be completed well in advance of the fair in 2019. The Lent Lane Fountain Restoration, again, that was a partnership with the Kinsman Club and the HBIA with a $5,000 contribution from the municipality. We had hoped that we could complete that restoration at that price. However, through further investigations and detailed quotes that we've received, it's not feasible to do it, not even remotely close to that amount. The hope was to relocate it to Kin Park. So we are looking, working with the two groups and looking at what potentially could be done to at least restore the structure itself. And so that's something that we'll be working on in the very near future with those two groups. And we'll report back to council with respect to that particular project. In the capital budget, we have 8 projects included for a total of $286,000. And 10 projects were not included in the budget at a cost of $295,000. As I spoke to earlier, the columbarium we have 3 of them, and right now we only have 15 niches available. So we're looking at purchasing one at a cost of $70,000. As well, for the cemeteries, upgrading a 2009 lawnmower. It's exceeded its life expectancy, which usually typically is 5 to 6 years. And we're looking at replacing that. The $10,000 contribution from partners would come from the welcome operating reserves that these were funds through the transaction of taking ownership of that cemetery that we can actually use for purchasing of equipment of benefit to that cemetery. And of course, with our fleet of mowers, they were used in all of our cemeteries, so it would be a benefit to the welcome, plus the trade-in value of $2,000. In the arena, we have the West End desiccant dehumidification system. So there are 2 units in that arena. In 2018, we replaced the one located at the East End. This one is over 10 years old. I actually remember the day that I replaced it because it was done on an emergency basis when it broke down as we were making ice. But plan is to replace that this year, and it's at a tax levy of $40,000 with some funds available through Viridian for grants, albeit very small. We also have a vehicle that's in very poor condition, 160,000 kilometers, requiring about $3,000 in repairs, and we're looking at replacing that vehicle, the 2-door, 4-wheel drive vehicle, the amount of $34,000. We've determined the trade-in for that existing vehicle is about $1,000. The ice edger at the Jack Berger Sports Complex, again, a vital piece of equipment to maintain the ice. This unit's fairly old. It's actually exceeded its life expectancy, and we're having some issues with it. but in addition, the technology today is that we could purchase a battery-operated machine versus a gasoline-powered machine, which that one is, which obviously can create challenges with emissions, CO, in the arena. So we'd be looking at replacing with a battery unit at $6,000. The sander for our truck, so it's a unit that fits in the back of our pickup trucks. As we do maintain all of our parking lots, including at all of our park facilities that are used in the wintertime. So that sander, the actual box itself is fine. It's the mechanics inside it that are corroded, and because of the age of it, we can't find any replacement parts any longer. So we're looking at replacing that at a cost of $8,000. Penryn Village Playground, in our 2010 Leisure Services Master Plan, there's a recommendation that consideration be given to placing a piece of equipment within that particular village. I have had a number of residents that live in that area express the want and desire to have a piece of playground equipment, And so we've included that in the budget this year, but it would be funded through DCs, as well as the parkland cash in lieu, which we feel is appropriate given that there was a contribution with that particular subdivision for parkland cash in lieu. So it would be appropriate to use some of those monies for that. The roof replacement at the library. So we've got an assessment that there's basically three areas that are in very poor condition, and we're recommending to replace all of it and going with a steel roof. Of course, with steel roofs, you're looking at 50, 60 year life expectancy, and certainly something that staff would recommend where appropriate to go to steel. We did it at the Town Park Recreation Center for the same reason. Shingles, typically nowadays, you might get 12 to 13 years out of them at best. So just a summary of our capital projects, as identified earlier, are located here. Some of the equipment that, or some of the items that are not included, were put forward, is some furniture upgrades for the Town Park Recreation Center. So this is continuing with replacement of tables and chairs. A power box rate, which would be used for maintaining our trails as well as our ball diamonds. Cemetery paving, there's some areas in the cemetery, Union Cemetery, that we have some issues with the pavement as far as the condition of it, and there's some areas that aren't paved at all. But again, we were looking at deferring that. A parks lawnmower and the 3/4 ton truck and trailer. It was a plan that we put forward to be a little bit more efficient. At least a one-time cost, where we basically split our grass crew in half so that we could send them to different areas in the municipality versus all of them going in one vehicle with lawnmowers attached. Kitchen upgrades at the Town Park Recreation Center. The building was built in 2002, and let's just say that the materials that were used were not of the highest quality, particle board for the most part. And for a kitchen that's heavily used, it is certainly showing wear, and we're constantly completing repairs. The emergency exit paving, we currently have an area on the south side of the sports complex that there's chips and dust compacted down, and that area is for the fire department to access the standpipe in the event that there was a fire. So that area is still accessible, and when we do plow it, albeit every year we have to go in and do quite a bit of repairs due to the fact that it is chips and dust versus paved. Tow behind auger, due to tree planting, installation of signs, etc. Currently, right now, what we do is we rent the equipment, so we would propose to purchase one that we could tow behind. Geranium Homes Park developments. So we're looking at upgrades to a park that we just assumed ownership of. Jeanette, I think, a month and a half, September. Let's see if time goes by. So there is a park in that particular neighborhood that potentially could have some additional amenities and something that we would consult with the neighborhood with respect to what they would like to see in that park. So that one we have put off, as well as Lakeview Park upgrades. Although that may end up coming off the list as we work on potentially the subdivision development to the south of that particular park, that the proponent has indicated that they would consider doing some upgrades as part of their development to that particular park area. So we could be a win-win for us in that particular area. Levy requirements of $2.7 million, capital $233,000, $2.97 million levy impact, or $326 per household for PRC. I'm going to be happy to answer any questions the committee may have.
I'm just curious of the thought process, or what your reasoning would be for, rather than repairing the half-ton truck at $3,000 to replace it at $34,000, and what year is it? It doesn't say where.
I would have to pull the data sheet up to see actually what year it is. So I'd be happy to get back to you on that one, but I'm going by my staff's assessment that The truck itself, as far as the body, there's a fair bit of rust, and the box itself is fairly damaged just due to the nature of the use. But I could certainly get back to you on the age of that particular vehicle.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any further questions?
When we look at the playground equipment, and you've had some people who will come and ask about it, and it's a fair expenditure, how do we determine where the playground equipment should go rather than just response? Because I think you were talking about having a more comprehensive review of the parkland usage and the population around it. I don't know if we have equipment in places where it's not being used, whether we can move it around or not, but how do we establish the fact that that is a good expenditure for that area given the children, etc.?
Sure. the decision on that particular area was twofold. One, it was a recommendation in the Leisure Services Master Plan to consider that. But secondly, we have guidelines in that master plan in respect to where playgrounds should be, and it's based on an industry standard of about 0.8 kilometer radius. So basically, we're looking at 0.8 kilometer radius as to where playgrounds would go. And when you look at that subdivision impact, specifically around phase three, that area would be just outside of that 0.8 kilometers, because the next nearest playgrounds would be to the north on Rapley, and to the east at the Commons Park. As far as our review of usage in our parks, the focus in that particular area is on soccer pitches and ball diamonds. So we're honing in on those particular areas and looking at how can we ensure that those facilities are being used to the max versus, you know, this ball diamond being used twice a week, and this one being used once a week, and this one being used three times. So trying to consolidate and make sure that diamonds are being used to the max, and some of our what I would call better quality diamonds, such as, you know, Garden Hill, Optimist, Ledeca, and maybe ones that aren't at that same level of service, for example, King's Field, could that field be repurposed and used for other things? Maybe that's the area where that playground for the Penryn Village would go, is King's Field. So those are the types of things that we're looking at.
Given that municipal buildings are under your bailiwick, I haven't seen anywhere mentioned about Lakeland Place. I don't know if that's a budgetary consideration. And the other one is the hub in Canton. I've had some sort of discussions where people come forward wondering about what we're going to do with that property and whether it warrants perhaps playground activities there as well.
So with respect to the hub, we haven't given any consideration to the use of that particular property. One thing that we are looking at is expanding on our day camp programming. One of the things that we learned through a survey that we recently did with our rural residents for programming opportunities in that area is the want to see a day camp that's more focused on outdoor. So things like survival skills, nature skills like how to build a fire or those sorts of things, and maybe having an overnight opportunity for campers. So one of the things that we're looking into from a staff perspective is that may be a good central location. I'm not certain that would be a good location for a park, given, or a playground, I should say, just given its location and not having very many houses close by. But that would be one consideration that we'd be looking at is, and if we're going to do that, what would that involve? Would it involve, a campfire pit if the chief will let us build fires in our parks? And could it include benches or areas for camping equipment? Those are sort of longer term plans that we're looking at. And I'm sorry you had a question before that and I totally went.
Lakeland.
Oh, Lakeland Place, yes, sorry. We did include some funds with Lakeland Place to do some improvements to the parking lot, and I believe it's $15,000 is included in that. But as well, we've included $7,000 to complete condition audit on that facility to get a really good, strong understanding what state that facility is in from a structural standpoint.
Thank you. Certainly, as we try to develop the facility out in Canton, you know, perhaps we will go forward looking at a little bit more public involvement. There are younger families, and maybe the 0.8 kilometer doesn't really apply in the rural area versus having a playground. With respect to Lakeland, I mean, it's been a strategic acquisition for the municipality, and I would be reluctant to see it sit there empty and not being used as even as a structure if there's opportunities to generate revenues. So certainly as we go forward, taking Lakeland and doing the assessment, absolutely the parking lot needs upgrades, and hopefully that's a revenue generator. And then the building itself, as we move forward, you know, perhaps we can start to look at some options, even if they're interim, to generate storage or any kind of revenue. Thanks.
I like your idea on survival training. That means we don't have to build any outdoor structure. Have to let them survive on their own in the hot sun. Men are men. And, two questions. Do you think you can hit your revenue targets for the ice rental? Because you seem to be, I think you're at 123 on a 226 budget.
We're going to be fairly close to that, taking into account that these figures that you have before you wouldn't even include rentals that we've collected for the month of October. So we're still, like, we would invoice for October in early to mid-November. So we're still collecting payments from back in October. Not that anybody's behind. That's not an issue. It's just the way that we invoice.
Yeah, I kind of thought it was a timing thing. And the PRC administrative advertising, was that a typo? Because it's jumped from 666%.
It's a consolidation of all advertising accounts into one.
And does it fit?
So we had advertising accounts in PRC admin and programs, aquatics, town park, is that it? Jack Berger. So we've just consolidated into one. It doesn't make sense to have six different advertising accounts when we're advertising for the department, and as a management team, we'll make decisions on what our focus would be. But we are actually rated to a key part where we do a significant amount of advertising for our winter sessions and our holiday programming coming up, and it's through magazines, radio ads, and things like that. So typically in late November and into December is where we would spend a large chunk of that advertising monies.
I see that you included a decrease in pretty well all the buildings in terms of hydro. Is hydro generally coming down?
No, I think that where we're seeing the savings is where we've done retrofits to our lighting. So the sports complex, now the Town Park Recreation Center, we did the outdoor lighting at the Portal Community Hub. So we're seeing those savings from a hydro consumption standpoint with the LED program. It's been very successful.
Good, thank you.
And if I may, I can answer Councillor Meadows' question. 2008, so it's a 10-year-old truck.
Councillor Lee?
Jim, your major expenditure this year is the bottom of the pool. I know we've done that a couple times in the last 10 years or so. What confidence and how long do you think this expenditure is going to last for the pool? Because $145,000 is quite a bit, and it'd be nice to. Is there any kind of guarantee this time, or
so?
It's a huge.
It's a great question. It's been very difficult. We spent almost 2 years doing research on what we can do after the last shutdown when we had water coming up through the bottom and we had the delamination. And the process that we've looked at, what they're indicating, and when we followed up with the references that they provided, so other aquatic facilities, and that this surface treatment, it's still a paint treatment, but it's superheated. So in the end, it'll come out almost like a baked ceramic. If it's not ceramic, but if that's probably the best way I can describe it, they're saying it won't require refinishing for 10 years. And when we do the refinishing, it won't be even close to the cost that we're doing now, because this is involving removing all of that material that was put down prior to, in order to prep that for them to put their treatment down. So I do have a lot more faith and confidence in this product at moving forward.
Are you tracking the user fees and the CCC and the Y?
Yes. Okay. As a matter of fact, as I stated earlier, we do a 5-year review of our rates and fees, but we also probably every other year within that time frame, we still do our comparators to ensure that we're keeping up with the times, and if we need to make adjustments to our rates and fees, we'll bring that amendment forward. So one of the things that Julie and her team, they've actually started reviewing our market comparators, including our local comparators, for all of our rates and fees. So we've already begun that process.
And just for your own information, the architects have started on a plan for the YMCA to refurbish, rebuild, demolish. So they're going to give us a bunch of options.
We'd be happy to share our experience with the refurbishment of the Jack Burger with them.
Yes. Well, we're not going to connect. We're not going to connect the roof lines.
Just a question with respect to the washrooms and the activity up at Ladika. There's no, that went over budget, as we know, right? And there's no impact on this year. That was all sorted out through the reserves and what have you from last year. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
That's it for questions. Thank you.
Engineering consists of four divisions. Engineering, which is responsible for contract administration and design specifications for all capital projects, as well as development review of site plans and plans of subdivisions. There's the transportation division, which is responsible for roads, storm sewer, bridges, sidewalk, curb, as well as the newly formed municipal transit service. There's water, including water treatment and distribution, and sanitary sewer treatment and collection. The maintenance challenges in works and engineering include 850 kilometers of paved roads, 226 kilometers of unpaved roads, 68 kilometers of sidewalk, 99 structures, including 23 vehicular bridges, 4 pedestrian bridges, 18 CN and CP railway crossings, 37 major roadway culverts, 17 significant miscellaneous structures or drainage systems and retaining walls, just over 1,600 streetlights, 8 traffic signals, 100 kilometers of water main, 111 kilometers of sanitary sewer, approximately 5,000 sewer and water customers, including residential and commercial, industrial, institutional customers, 5 sewer pumping stations, and of course the water and wastewater treatment plant. Our main initiatives for 2019 include the extension of Pemberton Road, which is extending Pemberton Road from Box Road to Henderson Street, as part of the expansion of the business park. Brown Street reconstruction, which includes fully reconstructing Brown Street from Walton to Bedford, which includes water, wastewater, storm, sidewalk, and curb. Rural road resurfacing and a tandem truck replacement in the rural area. The operating budget for works and engineering, the general operating includes engineering, roads and transit, and then the water and wastewater for a total of just over $12 million. The requirement from the tax levy is just under $4 million at $3,999,000. The notable changes, we have a decreased financial requirement. As part of the 2018 budget, there was an approval for a transportation master plan as well as the water and wastewater condition assessment. This is not included in the 2019 budget. The street lighting contract, we undertook a retrofit program approximately 5 years ago to retrofit all of our street lights. We entered into a 5-year contract with our maintenance provider that funded or financed the retrofit, and we have been paying them back. We are, have now completed the principal payment, and so that is, reflects savings in our operating budget. Staffing costs have been reduced. We haven't reduced staff levels, but with the recent restructuring of the new Department of Community Development, there's been a few shifts from how staff positions are funded. The stormwater management facility maintenance, we've reduced that by $100,000 as we don't need to undertake a stormwater pond cleanout next year. There is still $100,000 in the budget for some maintenance work, some condition assessment work, as well as purchasing some materials for storm sewer improvements next year. The GOC building annual repayment has been reduced, transfers to other departments. There's a net transit decrease of $26,500. Previously, our transit service was maintained by a contracted service provider. Recently, council approved changing it from a contracted service to a municipal service. We're currently in the process of transitioning the service from a contracted service provider to a municipal provider. We have already undertook the roll service, is now operating as municipal service. We hope to receive new transit vehicles in January. At that point, it will be a fully municipal run service for a 1-year pilot project. At that point, we'll be reporting back to council and telling you how great the service is. We've already received a lot of positive feedback from people that are using the roll service. So the contract service has decreased, but there is a substantial staff increase. We've reduced the amount of provincial gas tax that we have been using to fund the service. Previously it was $150,000. We've reduced it to $75,000, and the $75,000 will go into a reserve to build up the transit reserve for future vehicle replacements. And transit units, because right currently the contracted service provider is responsible for maintenance of the vehicles, because they are mainly their vehicles, there's an increased need for maintaining our own equipment. So the increased financial requirement is offsetting reserve and grant revenue decreases, not allocating staff cost to capital. So as part of the 2018 budget, there was an allocation from the engineering department was transferred to capital. It really was just a transfer. It didn't actually result in any cost savings, so we transferred that back to operating. We've increased the traffic signal maintenance budget by $40,000, as well as the urban roads, bridges, and sidewalk maintenance, a total increase of almost $80,000. There are two service level recommendations from Works and Engineering, the first being the wastewater foreman, funded through wastewater rates. The annual budget impact would be the full amount, while the 2019 net, because we're not going to be, it takes time to hire someone, so it's not a full year, so the net budget impact is $73,981. And then the wastewater fall protection on buildings, it's a one-time payment to install a fall protection within the wastewater treatment plant. We have a number of capital carry forward projects. The Croft Roseland signalization, as well as Molson Street Bridge, were approved in 2012 and 2013. They were also put on hold pending proposed partnerships with the Port Hope Area Initiative, or CNL now, as well as the Bulch Road Drainage Improvements. Bulch Road Drainage Improvements is still on hold. We are moving forward with both the Croft Roseland signalization and Molson Street Bridge. They are in the capital budgets. We are, because they are rather old projects, additional money is required to advance these projects. The PRV installation study is somewhat on hold as well, pending the outcome of the detailed design review with Mason Homes. The standby diesel genset is in progress now, as well as the sanitary sewer twinning project that has been awarded to CW Services, and work has already started and should be complete by the end of next year. The transit automated announcement system has been on, is on hold until the delivery of our new buses. And then Brown Street design, Freeman Drive water main design, those projects are just on, currently ongoing. Wastewater treatment plant digester blower is, I believe, will be installed shortly. By February. The portable backup trash pump. That's part of the Hope Street pumping station. So once that is currently in the process now, once that's completed, that will also be completed. Choate Street and Pemberton are ongoing projects. The maintenance management system is part of the asset management plan that's currently ongoing, as well as the Lakeshore Road reconstruction and the Welcome Water Initiative. That tender has been awarded to Hardco, and it's anticipated that work will be starting in January. In total, there were 16 projects in the proposed budget, totaling just over $6 million. There were 15 projects not included in the proposed budget. Total for those not included was $4,645,000. So Pemberton Drive extension, construction for the extension of Pemberton between Fox Road and Henderson. It is anticipated that the new road will be constructed to an urban standard, consistent with the standard of the existing Pemberton Street. There's a substantial levy requirement, water and wastewater requirement, as well as federal gas tax and contributions from partners. So the contribution from partners is Maple Lodge Farms. When we purchased the police station, there was an agreement that they would fund a portion of the road. So that's their contribution. Molson Street sidewalk widening, again, it's a 2013 project. We did move forward with the tender last year. It came in substantially over budget. We did not award it and are seeking additional funds to move this project forward in advance of the cleanup work. It's funded by federal gas tax. There's also a portion from the county of Northumberland, and the contribution from the other partner is CML. Croft Street traffic signals, additional funding to install traffic signals at the intersection of Croft and Rose Glen. This project includes urbanizing the west leg of Rose Glen and urbanizing it constructing it to an urbanized standard to allow a sidewalk on the west side. On the east side, it will remain an urban cross section until such time that Rose Glen Road is reconstructed. $40,000 has been previously committed by the developer, and we're requesting additional $90,000 to move this forward. Brown Street reconstruction, that's the big one for this year, represents the replacement of sanitary storm, water main, curb, sidewalk, and asphalt on Brown from Walton to Bedford. Budget is $320,000 from tax levy, just over $300,000 from water, $239,000 from wastewater, and it's proposed to use the OCIF, or Ontario Community Infrastructure Fund, in the amount of $1,380,000. Rural roads resurfacing includes $50,000 for Lakeshore, which is from the Balch Road to the west limit of the subdivision around the bend at the railway tracks. $70,000 for McCullough Road, which is a partnership with Clarington. Wright Road and the 10th line. So this is proposed to use $150,000 from tax levy, as well as the authorized leave in the amount of $85,000. The authorized leave reserve use is, from what I understand, is a reserve that was put in place as part of the former Hope Township. It was used to fund temporary contracts for employees that had an authorized leave. It's no longer used, and it's recommended that we use the balance in this reserve and then close it moving forward to fund the rural road resurfacing. We're also proposing to replace the tandem axle snow plow in the rural area. It is our oldest vehicle in the fleet. We've had ongoing problems with rust in the sander hydraulics. The approximate lead time for a truck is 9 months from the date of the order to delivery. So this one, we are proposing that we use a portion of the funding for 2019, and then the balance being put forward for 2020 unless we are successful in other funding or grant opportunities to offset the cost of new snowplow. Now we are, that's it for the levy component. These are all water and wastewater related projects. So design the sanitary sewer and water replacement on Bruton Street from Bramley to Toronto Road. The existing 200 millimeter clay tile sanitary sewer requires replacement due to heavy roots and deficient joints. Replace the existing 100 mil diameter water main to improve fire flows and reduce maintenance costs. It's $50,000 for design in 2019 with an approximate cost of $912,000 in 2020 to replace the water and sewer. The SCADA view panels, as part of our need study completed last year, we've identified that the SCADA view panels at the pumping station of the wastewater treatment plant are in need of replacement and upgrading and for a total cost of $10,000. The electric pallet jack, another $6,000 from wastewater. The need study again identified that the electric pallet jack is needing replacement and upgrading. Staff only have a manual pallet jack for moving heavy equipment and tools to chemical. This electric pallet jack would eliminate the safety concern as well as change some tasks from a two-person task to a one-person task, freeing up staff to do other preventative maintenance tasks. A Fluke diagnostic tool was identified as needing replacement. This should also result in lower repair costs, less frequent replacement costs, and eventually change our annual contractor inspections to biannual or even less frequently. That's $13,000 from wastewater. Membrane replacement of train 3, $400,000 to replace train 3 of our 4-train system in our water treatment plant. It's an integral to the part of the drinking water system and the treatment facility to replace these on schedule as the strain on the remaining trains is heightened at the end of the membrane's lifespan. We have had Xenon, which is the manufacturer of the trains, bring forward a proposal very recently to enter into a 10-year contract instead of going to the large $400,000 replacement. We could look at, we are looking at potentially $179,000 a year for 10 years, which would allow us to have a certainty in what our replacement costs will be going forward. We have a one-ton truck replacement for water. The current truck is too small and is needed to carry more stock and equipment on board. A new addition for wastewater, the purchase of a new 3/4 ton 4x4 truck with plow. It's the existing truck is beyond its useful life and the municipal 10-year usage expectation. This truck will be, the existing truck will be sold and the sale value going towards the cost of the new vehicle. And then purchase two pumps for the dewatering operation redundancy. Right now, we only have two progressive cavity pumps at the facility and are different makes and models from one another and have no second pump to back up the continuous process operation. It's difficult to find persons that can service the current pumps and supply parts, or a new replacement pump in 6 to 8 weeks, as they are now manufactured outside of Canada. Both the current models are no longer manufactured and we do not have parts available for them either. So this is $65,000 from wastewater. We have a new wastewater division. We have really invested heavily in our wastewater division. We have 6 operators and labor, and we are now doing a lot of our work ourselves rather than contracting it out, which means we are looking for a trench box and a trailer to transport it. We currently only have one other trench box in the water department, which we do share on occasion, but and there's some jobs where you actually do require two, and it would be more efficient to purchase our own rather than renting one. It's another $17,000 from wastewater. A solar panel system, we've had the roof at the wastewater treatment plant, not the actual treatment plant, but the storage building has been assessed to accommodate a solar panel system. Our hydro costs for the wastewater treatment plant are approximately $400,000 and are only going to increase. The installation of solar panels on the treatments on the storage system will decrease our hydro consumption as and it's an approximate cost of $260,000. We are currently reviewing the Green Municipal Fund and in discussions with Viridian to see if we can bring this down, because there are a number of funding opportunities that we can hopefully tap into to reduce that cost. The capital summary. There were a number of projects not included in the capital summary, which include Lakeshore Road reconstruction, the storm and sanitary sewer relining program, an equipment trailer for our roads division, a tandem axle snowplow, a front end loader, a single axle snowplow, Peter Street, a signalized pedestrian crossing on Peter Street at Nelson, a sidewalk on Rose Glen Road. There are two sections of sidewalk proposed. There was a section from Ward Street to Croft, as well as from Croft to Phillips Road. Neither one of them are proposed to move forward next year. The tandem axle snowplow, Clayton Lane resurfacing, installing a signalized pedestrian crossing on Ontario Street, electric vehicle charging station, the bathroom renovation at the sewage treatment plant, as well as the treatment modification pilot project. Services charged only to the urban area are transit and the annual Christmas tree pickup. So operating $3,999,000. Service level changes to levy are none. Capital $1,284,000 for a total levy impact of $5,283,000. Dollars per typical residential taxpayer in the urban is $594 and the rural is $547. Are there any questions?
Would it be possible to put something as such a major project as Brown Street over two budgets? Could it go for 2019 and 2020?
So yes, we can. We certainly can. We can break it up into two phases. I just had advised that there will be additional. It will cost more to do it over two phases because you'll be paying for insurance, bonding, mobilization, demobilization, traffic control. You're paying for that twice. But again, it's in the big picture. It's probably only about $30,000.
Mayor Sanderson.
Two questions. What's a fluke diagnostic tool?
it's essentially a vibration tester for our pumps. So we can test the pumps to know to identify any problems before they actually become a problem.
Thank you. And not included in the proposed budget is electric vehicle charge station at $30,000. We've had some discussion about this already. And I know that it's a priority from the government perspective and there's funding. But I understood that eventually is a return on investment program rather than a cost. I don't know if it would be an upfront cost now, but could you comment on that?
So the electric vehicle charge station, that's actually two stations. They're approximately $15,000 each to purchase and install. We would recover the funds over a certain amount of time depending on the cost of installation, because we would purchase it. We have an account with the service provider. People put in their card and charge their vehicle, and based on how often it's used, we receive the revenue and we pay back over so many years. The number of years for the payback will vary depending on how often it's used.
Thank you. I'd like to have further discussions on that, just given that, you know, we do have, certainly in our, you know, community development concepts, our strategic plans, our you know, climate control, all those things, it seems that, you know, perhaps this is something that we should be looking at a little more, you know, positively. Two stations at 15 each, if there's a return on investment, is there a way to, and I see COBRA got some funding for a couple of theirs, that always bothers me, you know, but especially when we were talking about it first, but.
I noticed that there's, of course, on Rose Glen that we're not going to be able to address the sidewalks. And I was curious to know if we have a reserve fund where every year we can put so much in, so at some point we will be able to address more of the infrastructure when it comes to sidewalks. Do we have something like that in existence now?
So I believe the proposed contribution to the capital reserve is $500,000 this year.
And
for future infrastructure projects.
So how much of that do you think would be directed at sidewalks, do we know?
So the Roseland Road sidewalk project is a little unique because it's identified in our development charge study to fully urbanize and reconstruct Roseland through the development charge study. So it's really waiting for essentially Phillips Farm. Once that develops, we would then urbanize Roseland. So it's a little premature to be installing sidewalk in advance of doing that full reconstruction project.
True. So sidewalks just generally though around town, anywhere that need to be repaired. I'm just curious if we have a reserve that maybe we would put so much in every year.
We typically don't. Sidewalk repair is funded through the operating budget.
Okay.
It was previously only $20,000. Last year it was increased to $30,000. This year, for next year, it's proposed to increase to $40,000. It's just general operating.
Thanks very much.
Just a comment on the Welcome Water Initiative. We are at the point now where we have pretty well 3/4 of the people who are affected who have come on board now and said they are not going to allow the water into their homes. We've been told what we have to have. We've never been really asked as a community what we want. So we've come to the conclusion that we're all going to stand our ground and refuse the water put into our house coming out of a 6-inch line. So it's just something for council to be aware of when the project does start. It could be a pipe going to nowhere doing nothing.
Why would you refuse it?
Pardon?
Why would you refuse?
We believe there should be a full-fledged water main with hydrants through the community to serve the whole community, not 19 homes that are actually 18 homes and one commercial business. And if you're the 15th person who jumped in the shower in the morning, I'm afraid you're not going to get enough water to rinse your hair. You can only put so much pressure down the line without blowing every fixture out of the house that's hooked to the line. So you cannot put enough water through a 6-inch line to service the community. And we've done our own studies, and we are going to stand up as a community and hold our ground on it. Just to let council be aware of what is coming down the pipe.
Okay, we did go through a 3-year environmental assessment process that looked at different options. We modeled the water main, so there is sufficient pressure to accommodate the proposed use, which is only the existing residential uses in the hamlet. It does not allow for future growth, no.
Yes, I'm aware of the process. I am one of the affected homes too. And like I say, we have been told all along what our options were, but we've never been asked what we preferred. And when we have stood up and said, we want a full-fledged water main, it's been brushed under the bridge and said, this is what you're getting. So, like I say, we've got to the point now where we're going to stand up as a community and say, put the pipe in if you want, but you're not bringing it into our house.
Well, that's something to think about. Never saw that coming anyways. When we had brought this forward a couple years back, we were encouraging a bigger pipe.
This has been an ongoing fight since 1985, so it's not anything new. It's been ongoing for quite some time.
Thank you for that. Any other questions, surprises? No? Thank you. You want to break the game, David?
I'm going to suggest this is a good time to break. I also wasn't really sure what our timeline was going to be. I'm honestly surprised that we're finding ourselves here at 2 o'clock and not slightly after 4, which is nice. Maybe some direction from committee, because our next point would be to have the Police Service Board and Library Work Board present, which I didn't want to have them waiting here all afternoon in case we did come up with them. So I had asked both of them to be here Thursday morning. So we can either break and then have further discussion and review on what we've already covered this morning. We could carry on, start looking at some of the committees, the council, donations, community grants. Just wondering.
Can we do capital?
Well, we've already done capital. If I'd like to do an additional review of capital.
Yeah, additional review of capital. Okay. Would that be okay with everybody? And then follow with community consultation? Because I think we're going to need to look at the whole overall picture of capital and see what we're faced with, and then determine can we afford to do all the projects that's even proposed. Comments?
It's the other part, too, community grants, because we always seem to spend a ton of time on community grants. Are we going to have some of these people come in and speak to us, just to give them a heads up that, you know, we're going to talk about community grants? Because, you know, we always seem to spend a lot of time on community grants, every budget I've ever sat on. So just to give these people a heads up that are applying for community grants,
it'd be
just handy to have them here because we're going to ask them questions.
They're expecting it to be covered on Thursday.
Okay.
They are, however, not required to be here, and we also don't accept any delegations from them. But people who are anticipating coming to be here for that discussion would be here tomorrow, or would be here on Thursday.
Well, I would suggest then that we'll take the break and then we'll come back and we'll relook at capital. And if anybody wants to volunteer any of their operating funds, that would be a nice time to do it too. And we'll take a break for 10 minutes. Okay, what we're going to do is we're going to carry on as if the police and the library had presented. And then, so David will carry on, non-departmental, and then we'll go into the impact on the taxpayer, and then we can go back to capital, and if we have time, we'll get into the community grants. So you got 5 minutes on each topic.
So the non-departmental, I talked about it very briefly earlier, but interestingly, we often have some of our largest impacts that occur here. It's also one of the hardest areas to kind of be able to fully anticipate, and often if we do have, say, a surplus or a deficit, it'll be driven out of this area. We have decreased financial requirement next year, coming from several areas. First, the bank interest earned has increased. This is arising because we are continuing to manage our cash flow better. We're reducing the outstanding receivables, and also, as I'm sure you're aware, the interest rates are going up. If you do look overall in the detailed budget, you will notice that we actually earn a lot more interest. And then there is, and what we do is, a lot of that interest pertains to the different reserves. So we earn that interest and then we transfer it all into the reserves. The part that we include here in the non-departmental is more around funds that we have that aren't in invested reserves, like our general operating bank account specifically. We also have a PHI reimbursement increase. So we do get some general reimbursement from the federal government towards they kind of think of it as opportunity cost or due to the internal resources that we expend on the project internally. We take that recovery and we put it in the non-departmental area. And over last year's budget, it is a $60,000 increase. I'm very happy to identify the decrease in legal fees. So this is something that has, you know, increased over the past, or was increasing previously due to one specific legal challenge, which is now over. Last year we were able to bring the legal down, and this year we're bringing it down essentially by 50%. So it was $200,000, we're now bringing it down to $100,000, which even going back historically I think is below kind of our more typical you know, base run rate. So really happy to see that here. Certainly, you know, we always have a few items outstanding and a few things that may come up, but quite happy that we now feel relatively comfortable to be able to bring it down to this level.
Dave, just the terminology, bank interest earned increased by $60,000. Legal fees haven't decreased $100,000, they decreased to $100,000, correct?
Well, they've decreased $100,000, right?
By 100?
Yes, they're now at $100,000 as well.
So, okay.
Yep. Our payments in lieu of taxes have increased just over $35,000. And for anyone new, or as a refresher for anyone who isn't new, this is a bit of a challenging one. When so we issue property tax bills, right, for any of our regular taxpayers. When it comes to a property, though, that is owned by typically a more senior level of government or another government-related agency, there's legislation in place that essentially says, you know, they don't have to pay you, but we send them a separate bill, and what they call that is payments in lieu of taxes. And typically these are paid, but not necessarily always. You can think of a place, especially like Ottawa, where this would be very significant with a lot of government buildings. But it's just done differently, and those revenues are required to become part of the general revenues. They're not part of, you know, the urban area or the rural area. They become a general revenue, and this is just kind of the overall setup. So just a bit of conduct. Payments in lieu of taxes sounds weird, but that's what they're called. And essentially, we go and we invoice them what we otherwise would anyways. But it's a bit of a subtle differentiation that it's kind of, you know, they're paying it. But it is, it's a bit more discretionary. And when you think about this, you know, we clearly don't have any, you know, really significant, you know, federal government buildings here. But, you know, when you're driving on the 401 and you pass the en route, that is just inside of Port Hope's border in the rural area, right? It's these types of, you know, properties and things that we're talking about, so.
That was my question. I was looking for an example where that would be. When you look at Westerville and look at Cameco and OPG and large tracts there, are they taxed by assessment or do they fall under this category?
Well, they're all taxed by assessment. So regardless of whether they're regular taxation or payment in lieu of taxes, it's always by assessment, or almost always, I should say. The difference is, and you look, OPG is a good example, right? Because it's a provincially owned, so that's where we get into the payments in lieu of taxes. So, same as even some of the any properties that say CNL, you know, or anything related to the project owned in the area, they would pay taxes same as any other taxpayer, but it would be billed through payments in lieu of taxes. There's a lot of technicalities, you know, through it all, and there's this, but trying to generalize a little bit, but there is a bit of a difference, and just so you understand a little bit what I'm talking about here. We also have in-year tax adjustments. Right now, say for next year, are what they call the tax roll MPAC sets. This is what your base assessment is. But then as we spoke about earlier, during the year, we have, say, a property might get demolished, someone may add a garage, there might be a new build. So any of the adjustments that happen in the year, we actually try and anticipate those. and include some of that in our budget because we bill it as we receive that, that finalized assessment. That's what we call typically the supplemental taxes, is anything additional. And then at the same time, we have kind of in-year write-offs, which is the examples, if you removed your garage and all of a sudden your assessment decreases, then we get a notice and we would reduce that. Those are all types of in-year changes. The other part that is included in that favorable $99,000 is the discontinuation of the vacancy rebates. So that's something that Port Hope was strongly involved in working with the county. We went through a community consultation process, and in 2018, we no longer have that vacancy unit rebate where at the end of the year, if your commercial or industrial building had been vacant for a significant period of time, you could then ask for a partial rebate on those taxes. We've now removed that process and also removed a corresponding, I believe it's a $30,000 write-off from our budget. So that is that's contributing to that almost $100,000 in favorable adjustments because we no longer have to have a provision anticipating those write-offs. We've also reduced the contingency by $60,000. That brings us to $40,000. So certainly not as much as we've had in the past. However, we do have a stabilization reserve, so if something significant were to occur and we were to run a deficit for the year, we do have a stabilization reserve to be able to weather that storm per se. And in time, if we keep building up and have a bit of a capital reserve, and then the same will, we'll go forward as we have, if we have a capital failure of some sort, then we'll be developing more of a reserve on the capital side. So, but do note that's now down from $100,000 down to $40,000. Increasing the financial requirements within our non-departmental category, we have interest on taxes is decreasing, so it's decreasing $75,000 again this year. It's something that is continuing to decrease. It's kind of the one unfortunate part in having our outstanding tax arrears be lowered, but we are earning additional interest on the money that we do receive. And as Susan noted earlier today, our overall interest on taxes makes up less than 1% of the overall revenues, but we have continued to see that that shift. The Gannett-Arasca Region Conservation Authority previously brought their draft budget forward to Budget Committee. And you'll note, primarily driving their $15,000 increase this year is they are going through their own asset management planning process and identified what their annual requirement is, and then that gets shared among the member municipalities. And they are very lucky because I think they looked at a 10-year horizon, and they've essentially put all of theirs in place at once, which is great. As Amanda talked about, we can't do that, or else we'd be just adding just another $6 million to this year's budget. But while it is a $15,000 increase, they're absolutely doing the right thing. So good to see that coming forward. And then as the fire chief spoke about previously in terms of the change to the parking reserve. So in order for us to take the net parking surplus and put that into a parking reserve towards our asset management planning, really good step, which I do want to note, I previously identified that we have water, wastewater, and building that are all self-funding business units. Parking doesn't have to be a self-funding business unit. It has been the practice of taking the surplus and identifying how those are to be used. And we're really, our recommendation is to take the parking-related funds and put that aside for parking-related matters, since we don't have an adequate funding source right now. The outcome of that, though, as the chief noted, is if we are going to continue making contributions to the accessibility reserve, which we do have increased accessibility requirements, is to be adding $40,000 per year, and then to the beautification reserve, which we don't technically have any requirements, but there certainly has been a practice of doing so. Looking at kind of on average is what we've been contributing over the past few years, adding $10,000. So this is adding $50,000 in levy overall pertaining to that change.
Can I just stop here for a second?
Sure.
The contribution to beautification reserve, the I have the draft budget from the HBIA for 2019. It indicates that they'll have, at the beginning of the year, they'll have $24,976 in the surplus account. With the thought that community development is now going to be responsible for a lot of things that are going to happen in terms of capital investments in the downtown core, etc., that I question whether we need to give them $10,000 as to enhance the reserve, because they're really spending only $13,000 on beautification. So I think that we could make a case to say, you collect your taxes and you run your organization on that, and you step out of, you know, saying that you're going to look after Lent's Lane and we're going to repay Lent's Lane. That's beyond their purview. So I think strictly beautification and promotions that they can do with their own money, and we'll start channeling the reserve back into community development. Just a thought.
Yep. Just in concurrent with that, I mean, beautification is basically for them, if I'm not correct, it's the wreaths at Christmas, it's the flags in the summer, same kind of thing. So I concur with him. I don't know why we would put an extra $10,000 into that. It doesn't make any sense to me as well. I don't agree that we need to put that extra $10,000 in there when, you know, basically, and if I'm correct, through our director of Parks and Rec, do we not put up the wreaths? As well, and do we not? I mean, it just seems like a simple process, and I just wonder why. I agree with you. I don't think we should put that extra $10,000 into beautification, because parking puts money into beautification, and the final say on the money that comes out of beautification comes from council in the first place. So I agree with you. I don't think that $10,000 needs to be put in there, to be honest with you, because I think we do through Parks and Rec. I think, you know, we install the wreaths. We do. You know, those things can be done through our own department.
Through the chair, just to clarify, we do draw from the beautification reserve every year. We have for the last, I think, 3 or 4 years to continue to enhance and stay on top of the Christmas lights as well. So we have been using that reserve, and it shows in the operating budget from PRC, a $5,000 contribution from beautification for that particular item.
Again, parking reserve goes into beautification, it's generated by the municipality, not by the HBIA, correct? So why, you know, and ultimate say comes back to council, what money gets used out of beautification. So I'd concur with you to take that $10,000 extra and take that out of there. We don't really need it, in my opinion.
I think we're kind of in agreement with what we're saying. I think we're at cross purposes, though, that this is not about an HBIA budget.
No.
This is a beautification, and that's available to Parks and Rec.
Yeah.
as a separate item. I think when we get to HBIA and the contributions the municipality makes to HBIA, that would be a different discussion. So I'm happy that this 10 stays here, but it's targeted as a municipal beautification.
Yeah, so just to clarify, I guess, a bit of the history of it, because there is sometimes a bit of a misunderstanding, I guess, over whose money necessarily it is. Because I think for a certain point, it was money that the municipality, Councillor Lees is rightly identifying. It's municipal money that the municipality has collected and is choosing to put in a reserve for downtown-related beautification. But that money, I think, for a number of years was used based on, you know, often on a recommendation or a request from the HBIA, and almost became such that it was the HBIA fund. And that is not the case. I've been very clear about that, at least during my time here with the municipality. But certainly the HBIA can, you know, they can make suggestions or you know, comment on how they think that those funds may be used. So given that there's certainly the past direction from Budget Committee was to be putting some money into this, and that hasn't been the past practice. When we went and reviewed this as senior management team, we have set up the proposed budget with $10,000 going in every year. I completely agree, though, with the comments that there's no reason we need to have a downtown beautification reserve fund. My preference is always that we, you know, the money goes all in one, and then we decide what the highest priorities are, not it be seen that, well, we have some money set aside for this, so since it's just coming out of a reserve, you know, we might as well just go spend it because it doesn't have any levy impact. That I really try to avoid. Ultimately, because it has been identified, right, we are pulling $5,000 out every year. This would put us putting $10,000 in and then $5,000 out for lights. I'd be quite happy to add $5,000 to PRC's budget to parks for the purposes of the lights, if that is something that Budget Committee wants to continue doing. It also makes it more efficient for us from a finance side. And we could easily just continue the beautification reserve, which doesn't mean that we stop doing beautification things downtown. It just means when we want to do a project downtown, we evaluate it against all of our other capital projects and decide whether it meets that requirement or not, as opposed to putting, you know, aside some money every year and then kind of, you know, making it a bit more of a decision in that way. And I will note, my next slide will speak to the request from the HBIA towards for downtown, towards Lent Lane, and that's an example really where, you know, Lent Lane isn't the property of the HBIA, right? Ultimately, you know, those funds would be spent by the municipality through municipal forces, but it's really a recommendation coming from the HBIA, something that they think is important and would like to see progress. But, you know, to the point that's already been made, the municipality, you know, has, you know, full and final discretion absolutely on that. Is there any? I tried to clarify that. Are we good at this point? Okay. We can come back then after if you decide you want to make a change. So those are the main highlights from the non-departmental, and beautiful segue into the HBIA's request for Lent Lane, which is to replace the existing sidewalk with stamped concrete. The main points being that it would expand the walkway, it would remove hazards. We have had some different changes in the area where we used to have signs and different things, so it would remove all of that. It would improve the snow removal. It would give it a cobblestone look and generally improve the downtown feel. So for this purpose, $50,000 has been requested from the beautification reserve, and it could further be offset by the Main Street Revitalization Grant, and this has always been kind of one of the projects that we've identified may come from that that grant. So at this point, it's included in the proposed budget. However, staff do want to point out that it would, at this point, it's really been a concept that's been suggested by the HBIA, and you know, they did have come up with one or two kind of quotes to be able to support that part. But it isn't a project that would be handed over to the HBIA for them to, you know, decide and implement. Ultimately, it's something we would need to manage internally, and I think it's a such focal point that you would want an actual, you know, a plan coming forward and make sure that that was something that would be, you know, was approved by council before proceeding on. So at this point, we've got really the provision for it to be in the budget, and that's about it. So we just want to put that caveat in it. A little bit different than most of our projects, where once you approve, you know, we can start tendering and really get going on it. Okay. All right. Included pending Budget Committee direction is the committees of council, donations, and community grants. I will note that community grants in prior years last year was about $118,000. When we were overall looking at all the budget and the financial constraints, we decided that it was appropriate, at least from a proposal standpoint, to bring community grants down as well. So we brought it down at this point to an even $100,000. sort of end this, depending, we're ahead of ourselves, so maybe later on today for some of it, but this is something that every year staff ask for direction from budget committee on these three items. So at some point we will work through, we'll put all the requests up and ask for direction, and it'll be in the format you'll have seen on the website or in our package where it's got the summary and a lot of column to determine. So overall, a non-departmental, as you noted, all the payments in lieu of taxes and different revenues come in there. So this is probably your favorite department in some ways, in that it is actually a reduction to the overall levy requirement of just over $150,000, and has a decrease for the amount required from the residential, typical residential taxpayer of $17. All right. We'll move forward now, talking about the actual impact to the taxpayer, and noting that since I'm talking about taxpayer at this point in time, I'm talking about levy impacts. So here's how each $100 of the combined operating and capital levy is spent. So police is our number one spend at just over $27. Works and engineering is at $26.43, which means combined, right, it's over $50 or over half. Then we have parks, recreation, and culture at almost $14.50, and fire and emergency services at almost $10. If we look at those four services, really before we get into a lot of more support functions, say other than the library, that accounts for $77.82 out of every $100 is occurring in those four areas. Not surprisingly, but I think it's always good to be aware. This is a different way of looking at something that I know is a bit of a challenging concept when we talk about it every year. When the tax allocation methodology, which previously was not compliant with the Municipal Act, was reviewed and a determination was made in 2014. It resulted in about $1 million, right, that was going to shift from the urban area to the rural area as part of our becoming compliant with the tax allocation. Given the magnitude of that shift, right, we received direction to phase that in over 10 years. And what I'm showing here, you see in 2014, right, this is in the red, is the levy that is shifted to the urban area, being an increase in the amount of levy that the urban area pays. And then in the green is the reduction, the fully offsetting reduction that the rural area receives. And this started out just under $1 million. And every year, this goes down by $97,500. And you can see we're now over halfway there in 2019. Okay, it's just under $500,000 that we are doing in, as our shift. And this is really important to note when we look at the ultimate impact to the taxpayer. Right? This has a $38, right? The impact of the shifting every year, well, in the current year, it has a $38 impact to a typical resident in the rural area. And I'm pointing that out because we're building up to the consolidated impact of the taxpayer. And this is a fairly significant element. It's certainly stepping in the right direction, but I think it's very important to be aware of the impact that before we do anything else in the budget, right, that this is already a bit of a challenge. Now I'm going to talk a little bit in total dollars about how the levy is allocated. The first section up here is called the common levy allocation. And anyone who got their tax bill last year, we put out this nice, somewhat colorful piece of information that actually explains for different services, not just by department, but for things that we felt that the taxpayer would recognize, how much their tax dollars go towards each of these different services. And the majority of these services are common services, which means someone in the urban area pays just the same amount as someone in the rural area does, based on the same property value. So the majority of the services that we've talked about today all fit under that common levy. And that common levy is allocated out by the weighted assessment, or the total value of all the properties, once they've been adjusted based on their property type, whether it's industrial pays more than residential and farm pays less. And that part gets allocated out. But at the end of the day, as we'll see in a minute, you can kind of ignore the whole weighted assessment part of it. If you own two houses, one in the urban area, one in the rural area, they both have the same property value. For any of your common services, they both be paying the exact same amount. Where it gets a little bit different is when we identify special services. And that's typically where we are charging a service to one area or another, or both, but for separate amounts. So thankfully at this point we only have three, which is helping simplify things for our taxpayers. And we've got the police service. So you see in the urban area, we have $4.7 million. And that is the pure cost of running the Porthole Police Service. And then in the rural area, $572,000, and that is the cost for the Ontario Provincial Police. Okay. Then also only being charged to the urban area, we have our localized transit, both the conventional transit as well as the specialty transit for accessibility purposes. And then we have the Christmas tree pickup, because it is a service that's offered only in the urban area for the once a year pickup of your real Christmas tree. And so this is where the differentiation in terms of all of the services that we have, this is where the differentiation occurs in terms of, you know, like properties in the urban or rural areas paying different amounts. So from a special services standpoint, in the urban area, it's just over $5 million. In the rural area, it's $572,000. Then we get into, we have two adjustments. The first is the 10-year phase-in adjustment. That's at $187,500, which, if you think about it, we figure out the whole budget. And then what we do is we take $487,500, we reduce the amount required from the rural area for that almost $500,000, and then we add that to the urban area. So that's the adjustment that we do. We do that every year, but every year we do it for almost $100,000 less. Okay? Then we have the use of LRW funds. So last year we used the rural funds, was a little bit higher, where interest rates have been going down from an investment, from a typical investment standpoint. So it's a little bit lower, and this is just an estimate at this point. We won't know for a few months what the actual number is. But we're using the LRW funds in the rural area. We've also included the use of LRW funds in the urban area. Estimate of $205,000. It's higher because there's a higher amount of principal or a higher base in the urban fund. We did not use the LRW funds in the urban area last year. Instead, that became kind of the initial base money for our community improvement plan. However, we won't need those funds again in 2019. So it's recommended that we would use those funds in the urban area to reduce the taxation. So ultimately then, that's what creates this total special services final line, and that will match the line that is on the taxpayer's bill. They'll have a common line, and they'll have a special services line, hence the insert in their bill, but we often ask that question, and I anticipate you will be asked that question many times, but that is, those are the elements that actually make up that special services line on the tax bill. Brings us to your total municipal property tax amount. You can see through here the change compared to last year. So for the urban area, as an area overall, not that they pay their taxes that way, but just as an area overall, it is a 2% increase in the taxes. And in the rural area, it is an 11% increase in the taxes. Overall though, it is a 4% increase in the levy. That's why it's important to understand the different impacts here, because when we say 4% impact of the levy, there are a lot of other factors that go in there. It isn't necessarily 4% across the board. The next part here is the impact to the typical taxpayer. So this is based on a single detached residential home valued just over $250,000. As I was pointing out, we have our common services, right? So for all the common services, that cost is $1,579. It's the same regardless of the area in which the property is located. In our special services, we then have the values I previously spoke to. The part I want to note is on the 10-year phasing. So someone in the urban area is paying an additional $75 as a result of that. Someone in the rural area is saving $190,000. That savings last year was $241, meaning that before we get started on the budget, right, they're going to be paying $51 more in 2019, regardless of whether we did anything else to change our budget. Then we have the use of the LRW funds. Those weren't used in the urban area last year, so that's a $31 reduction over the prior year. In the rural area, there was a reduction of $81 last year, so essentially they're going to be paying an additional, or have $9 less of a savings. Overall, that brings the total municipal property tax in the urban area to just under $2,400. And in the rural area, it's over $1,500. So we're now down to having less than $1,000 difference between the two areas, since we're kind of hitting a bit more of that equilibrium. It means in the urban area, we're looking at a $76 increase, or 3.3%. Last year, that was $21, or 0.9%. And in the rural area, we're looking at a $130 increase, or 9.3%. However, last year, it was a $196 increase, or a 15.4% increase. All right. Moving forward with a bit of a view onto 2020, one of the things that I'm mindful of is as we go through any year's budget and we pull something out, or we say, we try and cut back, that often has an impact on future years. So one of the first item I'm going to identify, and these might certainly will be things we'll have an eye on that could impact our 2020 budget. So I'd rather tell you about these things now than wait until July, so that we're all aware of the impacts of the decisions that we're making. So the Joint Operations Center repayment, right, the levy impact of that is $91,000. The total budget impact, though, is about $130,000. And this one may seem a little odd, because it is a little bit odd, in terms of when we're doing our cleanup of accounts. When the Joint Operations Center was built and the plan came together, there was an amount that was referred to as internally funded, something that used to occur when we did projects, but it really didn't identify a funding source. So what we are doing every year is we are essentially raising through the levy $130,000 to be able to pay off the Joint Operations Center. Because we're paying essentially we're paying ourselves off internally, this is something that we can kind of turn off for a year if we need to, and this was a bit more of a challenging year not having had the growth. So while this isn't something that I love financially, in order to kind of mitigate some of those financial challenges, it is a tool that we can utilize. However, we do need to eventually pay that off. It is one thing though, I'll be looking to, should we be fortunate and have a surplus come the end of the year, in the spring, this is something we could look at doing so that we can actually pay off all or part of that amount that's still required to be paid for the JOC, and then instead not have this need to be added to future year budgets having a 0.5% levy impact. Another thing, given some of the workload with the projects we have in works and engineering, and also just trying to find some savings, the director of works and engineering identified that we could really scale back our storm pond management program for the year, cutting $100,000. But it is a program that we really, over the past few years, have actually just gotten going. So it is something where there's a lot more work to be done, and we would need to reinstate those funds to continue doing the required work in future years. On the favorable side, the Jack Berger Sports Complex pool basin repair that Director McCormick spoke to is really a one-time cost. So the net of what we anticipate to spend every year is that $120,000 over what is typically in our base budget. So we'd be looking to not have to pay that. So that is does take a bit of the pressure off. We potentially would want to look at returning the contingency to $100,000, although there would be no real requirement to do so. And we also have the 2019 annual capital spend increase shortfall. So as we noted in this year's proposed budget, we are catching up from the $107,000 shortfall from what we didn't have in our capital spend to try and keep to our $500,000 year goal. So we, that was one of the first things we had to look at. We looked at in terms of this year's budget. Similarly, in terms of the current year's $500,000 goal, right now we've got $350,000 in there, which means we're $150,000 short. Which means if we're going to aim to stand on plan, we would be adding $150,000 next year. So overall, these five combined, we're looking at a 1.4% increase. As I did note, there are different ways that we can mitigate, and most of these are not an absolute requirement for next year. But I do want to make you aware of it, because if we are going into the mindset that next year's budget is going to be 2%, there's 1.4% before we talk about any other challenges and next year's capital increase, right? So leave that with you for your consideration. And I'm happy to now be at the point where I'm going to talk about next steps. So as I mentioned, committee direction on the following: committees of council, donations, and community grants. So when the time is right, we'll look for budget committee to pull those spreadsheets up and have you indicate to us what it is that you would like to give to the organizations that have requested funds in those areas. Also looking to receive any budget amendments to be amended through motions. And I will note, as the chair indicated, we'll have a bit of discussion, I think, following this, but anything that you'd like looked into, or any options, really helpful from a staff perspective, if you can give those to us so that we'll only have Tuesday and Wednesday to review them, but at least we'll have Tuesday and Wednesday to review them. It's quite challenging if we come into Thursday afternoon and you want something looked into when we really we won't have the same opportunity at that point in time. And again, just anticipating at the closure that we'll have a budget recommendation to go to council so we can get going on our 2019 plan. And that is all.
Thank you. So can we look at capital? All the capital projects?
Mm-hmm.
And the key column here for council is the tax levy column, the second column. Can you just scroll down a little bit? The levy portion is $1,850,000, and the budget's sitting at 4% increase on the tax levy, and 1% equals $190,000. So we have to bring it down to 2%, we have to get rid of $380,000 worth of tax levy somehow. That's the simple way of looking at it. Now, the municipality has in the past paid for items in the year they bought them. So if we, let's say, took the fire tanker and bought it over 2 years or 3 years, we could lessen the levy impact. Same with the tandem snowplow, same as the boat. So if we're talking $315 for the tanker, $270 for the snowplow, and $21 for the boat, that's $615. We don't need that much money. We need $380,000 of that $615, and we could still theoretically purchase those other items, but over a longer period of time, and still bring the budget down by 2%. So, any thoughts on that? Or just go by confusing things?
No, I think it behooves us to get this levy impact down. I have a question on for the Director of Public Works, Jeanette. The Crop Street signals, where would you put them on as a priority, say in a year or a year out?
Cross Street Signals is partially a partnership with a developer for the Cross Street Al LeBlanc development. They've already paid a portion of this for the signals. It certainly could be deferred another year, as they're only in, I believe, their third phase of a multiple phase project. So the need isn't quite there yet. It will be in the coming years. Part of it was also in advance of the Port O'Berry Initiative, the truck route, it's the major truck route.
And this may be one of those timing situations because the developer isn't ready to go yet. I don't know how much time it takes to sort of organize this, but there's $90,000 there, and that's our portion, correct?
That's correct.
Yeah, and the developer, I think, is 40, is that?
So it's a 2012 project where the developer contributed $40,000 previously, and the municipality has already contributed $160,000, and a portion of that has already been spent on doing the design work.
Okay, no decision needed. Just I think it is an option perhaps to have that deferred for a bit.
It could be deferred a year, yes.
Okay, thank you.
So I was using
the wrong call. For tanker is 307, the tandem plow is 90, and the boat is 11. So that's 408 of levy. So that pretty well eats up to 2%. Just for those three, and then for the other consideration. This is where it gets hard.
Director McCormick, could I also ask you about the desiccant $40,000. Is it harder? Are we jeopardizing what you've already done if we defer that?
Through the chair. It's one of those pieces of equipment that I can't look into a crystal ball and say it's going to last another year or not. If it fails, the refrigerant that's in that system, you cannot purchase anymore, so it's done. It's not something that if it fails, we can repair. So if we deferred it, it's taking a gamble, but it may mean at some point, possibly, that I may have to come back to council this year and say it failed and we'll have to pull from a fund somewhere to replace it. So could we defer it? Yes, but there's no guarantees that I couldn't come back sometime later this year.
And the one that you've already replaced is the same age and it has already failed, correct?
We replaced the unit this year in 2018 that was budgeted for. It hadn't failed yet. But the assessments we got from our contractor was, you know, replace it sooner rather than later. And that's the same assessment we've received on this one. The one that we're proposing to replace this year is actually 1 year older than the one we replaced last year.
We do have another route, and that is that we don't know what it's going to be, but there will be a surplus. An operating surplus for 2018 that we could apply to use those funds to buy back into things like the tanker and the snowplow and the boat. But it wouldn't, you know, that's not a guarantee, and it wouldn't occur until the beginning, you know, until we have a look at the final year-end results. But on the other hand, these things take months to acquire. Once you get them on order. So we have to take that into consideration also. But we don't know what the grants will be for Pemberton, if any, or Brown Street, if any.
Through you, Mr. Chair, to Jeanette. We talked about phasing Brown Street over 2 years, and the overall cost from 1 year to the next would be $30,000, you figure, the difference?
Yes, approximately.
Okay, so that would impact. I'm suggesting, but my opinion is for sure Pemberton has to be done right away. It's a priority for sure. And my opinion was we take Brown Street and phase it over 2 years, do two phases in order for us to take some money off the levy impact there for sure. I think Brown Street is a good sell to do it over two years instead of one. I'd like to make that recommendation if I could. Any other one, Mr. Chair? Mr. McCormick, the truck that you want to replace, I noticed you've upgraded it from a half-ton regular two-wheel drive to a 4x4 replacement, and you've got a $3,000 fix. Another question. I'm thinking it would be better to fix it this year for $3,000. And then you said it was in rough condition, but it's newer than my truck that I drive right outside, and there's not many conditions. And I know they're handled differently. I probably don't use my truck as hard as that one, but I noticed you've upgraded it from a two-wheel drive to four-wheel. Plus, I think $3,000 is, you know, spend it this year to fix it, and if it, you know, still has trouble next year, we'll then put it higher in the priority list to replace. Could you do that, possibly, Jim?
Through the chair, I actually emailed my Parks and Facilities manager that we had this conversation during my presentation. She emailed me back, and since we did that budget sheet, she had called Quantrills just to get a more accurate estimate. It's $5,000 to fix it. $5,000 on a 10-year truck that takes the abuse it does. My recommendation would still be to replace it, but would certainly, given the direction of Budget Committee, would certainly follow that direction. My recommendation would still be to replace that truck.
Okay, thank you.
Sanders? Yeah, through the chair on that same conversation, we support not fixing a truck for $5,000. That's getting the use of it. But we have talked in the past about leasing, and a lease cost and an upfront cost, there may not be so far apart. I don't know if you've looked at leasing. And secondly, I have looked at some trucks, and I hate to say it, but I think I could find one for less than $34,000. May not be the specs you want, but.
Through the chair, what we did as a municipality go through the exercise of looking at leasing versus buying. Unfortunately, I wasn't in the position I'm in now, and I don't recall the outcome of that. I'm looking kind of around it. Any staff, and you know, Rick's here, that may recall that conversation, but I believe that there was more efficiencies actually in purchasing versus leasing, but I could be wrong. Secondly, through you, Mr. Mayor, you're probably correct. If our budget's approved in early in the year, as it was last year, and if the inventory's there, there's a very good possibility we could see efficiencies in pricing by seeking to purchase a 2018 vehicle in 2019. Because as we all know, you'll get much better pricing as they're trying to move these out the door. What that amount is, I don't know. The amount that we've provided is based on estimates we received from local dealership and just what we've gotten over the last couple of years for purchasing trucks.
So we have four realistic things we could put on. Brown Street over 2 years, the fire tanker, the tandem, and the water vessel. And some combination of that to add up to $380,000.
Now through the chair, I'm not sure that I remember you put the water vessel on that. And I think the chief said we've had three events in the past year where it was needed, seems to be from a safety perspective. I heard a couple of the stories about the people stuck out from the harbor that, it's not such a big expenditure, but it seems when it's tied to safety and responsibility, might look at those bigger items more.
Yeah, it is a relatively small item, I agree. You guys don't have a rowboat, eh?
Mr. McCormick, the column burial, that's a payback, right? And how many, what's the, over the years, 4 or 5 years, how many years does it take to pay that back? So it's really a wash, right?
It is. In the beginning, it's a big way. Obviously, I mean, right from the get-go, all the buildings are sold. 40% are goes to the trust account. 40% of that sale goes to the perpetual trust account. That's for perpetual care of the cemetery.
Right.
So that money is not available. Other than the interest is earned on that investment.
There's a $70,000 levy impact right up by purchase.
Like up front.
But that doesn't come back into the.
Well, we'll cut 60% of it comes back into the house.
And you can't charge accordingly to balance that out, or how does that work? I'm not sure.
It's set up in the fees that the cemetery upon for that quality area. Yes, there definitely are revenues that come back in the kitty. I'm so sorry. Yes, there are definitely revenues that come back in right from the very first sale.
Right.
But just understanding that part of the cemetery's act is that every sale of columbarium, 40% goes to the trust account, the existing perpetual trust account, that the funds are in perpetuity for the care of that cemetery. But yes, there every sale there's 60% of the revenue comes back.
So we don't have to make the decision right now, and we can make it on Thursday. But right now we're at half of Brown Street, 160. Half the fire tanker would give us 150, and 70 of the tandem would give us 380. So that would leave 150 plus 20, which would be 170,000 that you could use to to buy the tanker and the fire and the tandem over a 2 or 3 year period. Councilor Lees?
It is, you know what, fire department, to me that's a safety issue, and I'm not real fussy on Brian. You know, we know they asked for the world, they didn't really do us too bad this time.
I hate to give you, I'd like to give you two shots, that's the truth.
But no, it's safety, it's a safety thing, and I really, you know what,
But you're not going to have that tanker till probably September anyways, and it'll give me the ability to spend $150,000 this year and $150,000 next year to acquire it.
But again, that's an old vehicle, man. I know, you know, being a past fire guy, that's an old vehicle.
You still have to order it. It's still going to be old.
It's still not going to take a year to start to get it. A year?
Through the chair, we've reached out to a couple of different companies just to see what's available from a stock perspective, and if we put an order in January, we could have it by grass fire season, so it's something that could be taken by delivery by April, latest of May.
So would they take a $150,000 deposit and the balance financed?
That I don't know.
Because that's
something I can take a look into.
And the other thing is, we have no bank debt. If we want to, we can make a loan and use, perhaps look at David. Just like I handed you a lemon, eh? I don't think, no, but we can, you know, we've got the LLRW fund use, we have potentially a surplus coming at our way that we could use to pay off the bank loan if we really had to. So there's some options. We don't have to, you know, spend all the money in our pocket in 1 year.
And again, I think when you look at the priorities, as Councilor Lee says, you know, safety, etc. we're not so far out here, and certainly if we can string a few of these things out, we can get pretty close. And as far as the LLRW funds are concerned, we have been putting 20% back in there. I don't know if they're available even on an internal loan type basis.
So that would be $60,000 we could secure a loan. I mean, $60,000 is just going back into the pot, and if we made that available to pay off interest and principal payments on a bank loan, we could do it in 2 or 3 years.
And I don't want to anticipate this, but I think we've had a lull in certainly development charges and growth, and that's fairly unusual over a period of time. And I think every indication from the departments we have is that it's not going to be sustainable. I don't know whether we'll have a surplus, a little one this year or not, but I suspect if we looked at the upcoming development charges, we know some are there for sure. Phase 4 is going ahead, et cetera. They're not to spend the money before we get it, but also not to compromise too much on priority needs. And I want to comment as well that this budget really is a good budget. The directors have done a lot of work on this. It's easy for us to sit and kind of like pick this apart a little bit. And while I get the chance, and I don't forget, the presentation has been amazingly great. So that's why we're here at 2 o'clock, still talking about things we weren't going to talk about till Thursday. So good job.
Susan?
From the chair. Just to clarify on the columbarium, so this is an 80 niche columbarium, and so after 4 years sold, the columbarium will pay for itself. So quite right, 3 or 4 years this year we're right now, and that is with not having the fourth quarter reported. There's been 12 niches sold this year, and this is kind of. Just from sort of a recent personal experience, the way most people are going now, a lot of people are going to the columbarium, the niches, rather than in-ground burials. So I think it's important when the cemetery is telling them there's only 15 left.
And we don't want to speed up the process of selling.
Is there a lead time to order Are they readily available, or how does that work?
Through the chair, I'm not sure what the lead time is. I can certainly follow up with my staff.
Okay, well, we do have some options that we can re-review on Thursday in terms of getting it down to 2%. Now, we're going to come into a situation where we have to look at community grants. Director Baxter, does this include the potential hospice donation, the budget?
The budget includes the $100,000.
This next year? Okay.
How that gets allocated is up to the budget committee.
You wait a second. The $100,000 is for all community grants?
Correct.
So that doesn't mean, that would be inclusive of hospice. Okay, so we're going to have a ways to go on that. Maybe we should have a look at community grants.
Do you want us to wait till?
Well, I think we're going to need the time just to digest it, just like we did this, and then we'll go back at it again on Thursday.
No, it's all in a while.
I just think, just so we can get a feel for what we're going to be looking at. This is just a rough draft of one potential way of going. And you can see that not everybody's going to be thrilled.
Just sorry if I have to interject. We had plenty of conversation about proposed methods during that last go round, but are we in a position where we require direction at this point to make those changes? Or is council in a position to?
Capital items, you mean? I think I'd rather wait till Thursday. So the directors know what way we're thinking. Do you need any clarification? And we haven't made a decision yet, but we've thrown out some options.
Well, I do want to make 2 points. So one is, we don't have a cash flow problem right now, thankfully. We've borne out of that. So I absolutely would not be looking at taking out any sort of short-term bank loans to be able to, you know, we have enough money in the bank right now to buy the fire truck tomorrow, right? The issue is that we need to be funding things as we go, or else we'll end up in the same problems where we just kind of finished crawling out of, where we were going and doing things but identifying a funding source, and that catches up to you very quickly, right? We're still trying to pay those old things off from the past. So it isn't so much about us not having the cash, you know, necessarily to be able to go and do one or two of these things, but they all have to be funded somehow in order for us to be sustainable. So it really is more so about where are we going to come up with, you know, the $300,000. And we can take that $300,000 and we can put it aside and we can do it over 3 years. But the reality is then we're not going to have that tanker for, or whatever it is, take on the fire truck, for that period of time. But more so, I mean, we could buy in the second year and then pay for the third. But it then means that of our capital, we're then going to be committing money for the next 3 years. So if we start taking these projects and split them out over 3 years, and we're going to continue, you know, not doing the increase in our capital funding and continuing on, then I just have to caution against that, because we have a lot of, you know, a lot of needs. You know, it isn't just Brown Street. You know, next year we have Lakeshore Road that's on tap right now, but if we're going to push Brown Street out half a year, then Lakeshore might be, you know, 2 years out, right? There's only so many funds to go around, and if that's fine, then that's okay. But I do just want to point that out, because if we take some of these bigger projects, split them out over 3 years, then the next two budgets that you look at as a budget committee will be paying off the things that you committed to do this year without really doing, you know, a whole lot in addition. So it does kind of start to handcuff you over time. One of the things, you know, a few years ago, I remember when we couldn't buy, you know, a single snowplow truck with the amount of capital funding we have, and we needed to buy probably four at the time. And it's only been the fact that we've been increasing our capital funding, right, every year, not always necessarily to plan, but we've really tried to stick to that plan and move that forward. And that's what now enables us to be able to buy a snowplow truck if we need to. Typically, it's the first year where we're still trying to keep to that plan of kind of doing that replacement a year. But purely, you know, trying to cut this by just phasing, you know, the capital that we want to do now over 3 years is really not going to set us up very well for the next 2 years. So I do need to leave that caution.
as a counter to that, if we put in a tax increase, it's forever. So, like, we put in 4% now, that carries on forever. It does, yeah. You can never take it back.
You're saying that, but I'm not going to go out and sell a 4% increase to the taxpayer.
Well, okay, no, but I'm just saying, if we did do that 4%, it stays forever. So that's why I'm saying it would be very nice to have a 3 or 5 year understanding of what our revenues are going to look like down the road, so that we don't have to do things year by year by year. You know, like, we're going to have 4% growth next year. Well, that covers, you know, that covers off a whole lot of problems that we're dealing with this year without having to increase the tax base.
Which is true, but if I was to forecast out for you right now what the next 10 years would look like, right, I wouldn't be able to tell you it's going to be 3% growth this year, 0.9% growth the next year, you know what I mean, and going through because of the variables. So much of that is up to the developers, right, and it's up to when MPACT brings it online. We would still be looking at something, and, you know, I'd still be coming forward and saying, look, it's going to be between 2 and 3% per year, like 2.5%. And that's exactly what I did, you know, for Budget Committee in August when we looked at this. Right? The reality is just that, you know, we just hit a lull kind of for this 1 year. So, you know, if we want to look at this, I'd rather say pull 1 or 2 projects. You know, if you're going to go after it through capital, then, you know, pull 1 or 2 things, pull it down with the thought then the next year when our growth is back up, that we, you know, turn around then and, you know, reinstate that capital.
And not do anything over 2 years or 3 years.
Well, I'm not saying don't do anything over 2 years. We, you know, I didn't love it, but we came up with the trying to do the snowplow and extending that one over 2 years. It does have a long lead time, and that way we can at least, you know, order it. But I think, you know, relatively for the outstanding amount, if we do get a grant or say if we do get some surplus, we hopefully will be able to capture that within 2019 year, so that we're not putting any additional pressures on 2020.
Yeah.
Right at this point, we're already looking at adding about $150,000 for next year to try and keep on to our capital plan. But.
So, something for you to all sleep on until Thursday, and we'll have to make a decision.
And so, sorry if I can make my second point, just was that this proposed budget right now already includes the urban LRW funding. So if we were to take that and allocate something else, it means Alto is coming out. And I've actually, I know someone had a bit of a challenge, like, I'm happy to speak to some of the different scenarios in the way that we talk, or we could use that the LRW funds. Develop something for that if you want to have that discussion, but if nothing else, I do just want to at least caution that if we start earmarking that those monies for a capital project or any other project, we can't spend it in two spots. So it isn't bringing down 4%. It certainly isn't doing anything to help the rural area because we're already using the rural LRW. In the urban area, we can use it for something else, but it does mean that it isn't decreasing the way it's currently being, the decrease in the current budget.
Okay, here's the capital problem, and now we'll go to the community grant problem, issue, opportunity.
Do you want any comments on this, Mr. Chairman?
Oh, yeah, I'll comment on them. Yeah.
Okay, there
you go. Okay, so as you can see, the request and variances, and then the 2018 approved amounts, and we're trying to work with $100,000. And you can see hospice 2000, it just, the numbers have to be revised. I mean, they're not, the 2019 request we cannot fulfill. And can you plug in the 2019 proposed?
I will have that for Thursday, or unless you want to wait a minute, we can manually update it. We're ahead of ourselves here.
Yeah, that's fine. That's going up. Thank you. And that would give it, that'll give us $299,925, as you can see. And this is, you know, this is just one scenario that we could do. And as you can see, the cuts are severe. And that's why I'm trying to improve the capital budget so at least have some wiggle room here too. Sorry.
I happen to completely kind of agree with Coalition.
Thanks, sorry. And yet accepting the original budget from 2018 for critical mass, I'd far rather see 5,000 go to each than one get everything they had the last year and one get nothing.
No, this is the one we spend the time on. Forget about the other 18, 19 million. The 100,000 because it's so personal. Councilor Lees?
If we just took Capitol Theater and hospice alone, there's almost 100,000 there, really. Everybody else gets nothing. If we're going to stick to the 100,000, then I don't think we would. How do you just stick to those two and nobody else gets anything?
Unless we change the 100.
Yeah, the 100, it's not realistic. I really don't think the 100's realistic because, like I said, with those, just those two alone, it's pretty well your 100. Nobody else gets nothing in the whole community. So we have to somehow get the hospice thing in there. We have to decide. That was a $200,000 request that we committed to over 4 years. So that's 50,000 per year. And then, when you look at Float Your Fan, it was 30,000 last year as well. So there's over 100,000 right there. So it just doesn't make sense. So we gotta change that around somehow.
I concur with Councilor Vees. I mean, the 100,000 is an arbitrary number. You know, it's not one that we have chosen we have to live with. Right? And so if you look at our expenditures and we look at our capital, and you want to shift those around, you know, then the priorities, you know, from $100,000, as Councilor Lee says, the Capitol Theater is a revenue generator for the community generally. I think then we have some other benevolent, and we've committed to increasing culture, to your point about, you know, critical mass and the requirements we have from a social perspective. So I think when the current chair is absolutely, we spend more time kind of to work on this. And I think to Councilor Lee's perspective, probably $100,000 isn't going to do it. So if we're going to shift it up to some degree, then we're going to have to incorporate that increase to the capital cost decrease to balance it out.
So what we have done in the past is given everybody a poetic license to put whatever numbers you want in there. And see what we come up with. We can go individually. We can do this theoretically right now, and then again make the decision Thursday. But I think Santa Claus Parade, is everybody comfortable that with the 4,000? Mm-hmm. And that's being consistent year over year. Float Your Fanny last year got 30,000. That was the first year that we've ever funded that. They've asked for more money this year, but I say we have to make do with the money that they got. Sorry, go ahead.
on Flotrafani. I think it's a great promotional item for the community, but it's not a big revenue generator. I think that I would personally be asking the organizers to increase their funding from the private sector. I think there's room to do that. And if you look at the Capitol Theater, and you look at relative to the funding request, Capitol Theater, is a revenue generator all year long. And so when I look at those kind of items, I'm obviously a big fan of Flotrafani, and it's given us a wonderful press, but does it make us money? The Capitol Theater, on the other hand, is a community investment, both in our strategic goals, which are cultural and in nature, and it does generate. And I think over the last term of council, we asked the Capitol to pay more attention to their business plan, and they're going through some changes within their organization to try to make sure that they are at least revenue neutral or profitable. And they have a lot of costs ahead of them. So when it comes to some of those bigger ticket items, and you start to look at the hospice, the hospice again is not a municipality of Port Hope project, but it is a West Northumberland, and from an optics perspective and from a true need, hospice from the community has a high requirement. They've had a good go at fundraising. I'd be very reticent to back away from what we had as a commitment to the hospice. So I'm probably encouraging that we look at the 100, move it up, and take the capital costs to try to accommodate that to some level. Or we do what David would hate to do, which is borrow some money.
Okay, so make a reference. Give me some idea what you want to place here for hospice. 50?
We did move to 50, and then you just said 50.
Yeah. Okay.
Has that been committed to?
That's what they requested.
Okay. The hospice had requested it come to council. The other communities that are involved have fulfilled their commitment or committed. We held off our commitment both for this council and because it was late in our budget year. But we can address these. I'm not saying they're going to be simple. I would also suggest the Capitol Theater go no less than 40,000. They got 45 before.
Are you suggesting, Mr. Mayor, 40,000 for the Capitol? Put 40 grand in?
I'd go along with that. You want to do this right now with motions or just?
No, we're just making discussion, but we put the numbers in so we kind of figure out where we are netting out.
Okay.
Because it will tie in potentially to other budgetary areas.
Okay, so. And split critical mass.
Yeah. Sorry, just on the Flotrafani, when I look back and they were getting the 10,000 in 16 and 10,000 in 2017, not having been part of this process in 2018, I'm guessing, wasn't that their big anniversary year, and perhaps that's why it went from 10 to 30? No?
The whole new way of running, they brought in some expertise on how to change the whole process of how they ran the committee itself. So they needed some expertise, but I would say that Flotrafani goes back to 30, the same as what we gave them last year. Last year was a big year that we gave them 30, and I think we should stick to that. I don't think we should just...
So you don't think the 25 is in order when they were originally from 10?
I don't really know.
I think the profile of that event has become quite large, and the activities around it are more. And I really do think there's room in there to get an increased level of sponsorship from the private sector. Yeah, they've started to get some from liquor, not as a drinking thing, but as promotion. So I think if we push them and can perhaps help them, but I just can't see that much money going into something that doesn't generate revenues for the community. Yeah, and they've had a good go. We've been very supportive over the years. So and we've done the same thing with the Capitol Theater. We've pushed them to become more profitable, get a little bit more efficient. And I think, Flotrafani, we should be doing the same thing. I'd take 20. Yeah.
when they, everybody submits their budgets, are they just submitting what they'd like, or are they submitting a breakdown of where they're going to spend the money so that when we get to this point, we can look at what they're going to spend it at and then make a better decision whether we want to leave the funding where it is, or we can decrease it one way or up or down. We're just getting a ballpark figure. We have no idea how they're planning on spending the money or where they're going to spend it.
They do provide detailed summations, and so it's in there, whether it's truth or not. Everybody has a wish list, and they all good intentions. Most of this is volunteers, so we've got to be respectful of that.
The other group that I think has worked very hard is the Friends of the Wesleyville Village, and that again is a cultural and sort of a rural focus. I think we used about $3,500 or so last year to defer their permit fees or whatever they needed from the community. So I would certainly be supportive of giving them something. They had asked for $11,000. I think that's going to zero is a bit extreme. So, as I say, I think from a heritage perspective, a rural perspective, and a cultural perspective, I'd like to put something at least $2,500 or something there.
So this isn't your first time?
This is the largest amount that they've asked for.
Okay.
Every dollar helps them.
Then the only one we haven't covered is physician recruitment.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
They do a great job, and over the last few years, since back when I was on the committee, they did. They brought in doctors quite regularly, and doctors in all of Northumberland is in high demand, and this money to me has been well spent over the last 5 or 10 years that they've ran. They do a good job and run a tight ship, and they do bring in a lot of doctors that have done well.
Okay.
So I would support that for sure.
Over the last year, or over the next year, we're looking for two additional doctors in Port Hope, and that $14,000 fee covers relocation costs of $10,000 per doctor. That comes out of the common reserve. So it's the best deal in town as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you. Thank you. The only other one I comment on is the one for 89.7 FM, the art gallery. I think, again, the art gallery, that's another cultural thing in the community. I think we need to put some money in that as well. At least $5,000 as well spent there, because it keeps it. There's been one art gallery presence here, and the majority of it's in Culver, but that $5,000 helps with maybe keeping the art gallery here in the world. So I think that's all part of arts and culture.
Councillor Lees, just on that topic, the relationship between the art gallery, the Northumberland Art Gallery, and the Port Hope presence, I think they pulled out of Port Hope, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, I think that's why the sponsorship was asked for 89.7, because they're the ones that are fronting it, but I think they're looking for money and support from us. In our community, that $5,000 is going to be spent rent a home here, more than that.
Yeah, so, but that's the clarification I would like, because the Northumberland kind of did have some political issues and it got pulled out of Port Hope.
Yeah.
So if the money is to have some establishment presence in Port Hope, mm-hmm. I'd be very supportive. If it's going to the current without a Port Hope focus, I would not. So if we could get some information on that.
As long as the gallery stays here, right?
Yep.
Yeah, I'm good with that too, yeah.
Well, great job of whittling that down.
Yeah, that's true.
We did a good job on that. So if that is, again, if that is the wish, if that's what you feel on Thursday when you get back up and address this topic, we can put 5,000 in Northumberland Gallery. And then, so now we're looking at, we need 380 plus 46 to come off the levy. So 426. I think 427 is the size of a good sized motor. And how are you going to address that on Thursday? Yeah, this is, as Mayor Sanderson said, this is, nothing is cast in stone here. It's just some ideas, thought starters for our Thursday conversation.
And I'm sure with us changing those numbers around, we'll get phone calls before Thursday comes around. Which is great, you know what? That's what the company is all about, and this is a public thing, so. Yeah, it's all good. Yeah, me too.
Any further questions or discussion on this part or the capital plan? David, do you have anything else you want us to review in 10 minutes? Councilor Leeson?
The chamber request, is that built in, like, was that, how, like, I read that part of it, but I was kind of confused. It's built on tickets and dinners and stuff like that, as long as we contribute, it's kind of, yeah, this question, you know, how that one works.
Okay, all right, just wondering. What do you
want to do now? Well, if you want to utilize the time, you can make a motion, sir, that fits within the envelope. 10 minutes, so that would be an easier one.
Okay, okay. Donations. Okay, sure.
So if I may, Mr. Chair, this $5,000 was put in the budget last year, of which the $2,800 was planned for, and we really haven't had anything else come up during the year that I'm aware of. So we're actually under budget on donations from last year, or in 2018, I should say. And overall, this year, the requests are increasing, and there's $4,500 that has been requested in this year's budget. But also, remind that if something isn't an annual event, we do accept it mid-year. So there may be requests that come in during the year. I will just note that from a staff perspective, that the GRCA is one that we're already funding our share of. This is obviously an additional event part, but we just point that out to the group.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised to see that on the list.
I'm not sure that we have to approve any of these or even consider them. I mean, the line item is, do you want to stay at the $5,000? You know, at this point in time, and I personally would support that. You know, we have that ability to donate, you know, throughout the year. These individually, we can choose sort of as they come up, but we have a more detailed discussion about each one of them as we go forward. But I'm totally comfortable if you have, you know, discretionary $5,000 for donations that come up during the year.
Sorry, just in reading the GRCA, it's because it's their 30th anniversary is the reason they're requesting it, and one of their corporate sponsorship.
No, it's good. I understand that. That's for the dinner and stuff, isn't it?
Yes.
For dinner. You know, I pay it out of my pocket, so I don't understand why the $500 extra bucks, but
the JCA's thing. I think that's the main big project for this year, but they're trying to raise $160,000, and that's mostly for the kids at the Navy League and stuff. So I'm okay with that one.
This is Jay Peter.
Yeah, that's
nice. You can add that one.
That's Junior Achievement. We gave them money last year. If I recall, they got funding for the other schools in Fort Hope, and last year that was the funding for them to come to one of the other schools, so that all the schools in Fort Hope had the Junior Achievement, if I'm thinking of the right one. But we didn't have it last year.
It runs like in the grade 5 program at different schools, so all that business response, yeah, entrepreneurship.
Well, we could use the $5,000 as a placeholder and address them as they come up. And see when it's gone, it's gone.
Through the year, Mr. Chair, when they ask them, they'll give them the money. If they don't ask, they don't give them the money. Up to $5,000. Did you already mention something you wanted a little bit more flexibility? This is a separate.
This is specific donations.
Correct.
Versus community grants, as we saw in those schools. Mm-hmm. Schools ask every year and then they're contractual.
Okay.
So, Mr. Chair, if you want to stick with the $5,000, that's what's already in the proposed, you really don't need to do anything. But I believe it was 2 years ago, the budget committee, instead of having all these things come up, just kind of one every meeting or two every meeting, said, no, we want to consider as many of them as possible all at once, give direction on them all at once for efficiency, so we're not writing individual reports for each one of these. So certainly from an efficiency standpoint, if we're keeping with that, you know, it doesn't need to be today, but Thursday or potentially at the January meeting, but at some point, would need direction on these because this is their application. They're not going to apply again. We actually wouldn't allow them under our current practice to apply again in March. All right, one thing is the $5,000, the other thing is who we're going to award to, which no, we don't need to decide that today. Typically, we would decide that, you know, before the end of the process, but we could also decide it in January. That would be fine too. Just we do need a bit of decision, otherwise, you know, finance won't issue any response to these.
Just a clarification, Director. So have these already been requested, or are they just from the last year?
Oh no, they've all had to reapply this year.
Okay.
Yeah, all their applications are in the agenda and on the website under donation, the 2019 okay. Donation requests.
Thank you.
How would council like to proceed? Thursday? Not a lot of work to do Thursday. Okay, Thursday. Perfect. Yep. Okay. Thank you.
So, Mr. Chair, just going back to just looking at the amounts. Going back to the capital, sorry. So, looking at the capital, one of the things we do try and balance a little bit is the capacity we have internally and the timing on these different projects. We're looking at Brown Street, and I should know, we have two kind of main sources that we have funding towards some of these, especially these major projects that Amanda Aysen spoke about earlier today. One is federal gas tax funds, and the other is the Ontario Community Infrastructure Fund, or OCIF. If, at this point in time, as a senior management team, we allocated out those funds to a level that we say we're comfortable with. The federal gas tax funds, we get $500,000 each year, roughly. And what we've tried to do is maintain $500,000 in there at any point in time, not spend the whole thing, because we do have these big projects, you know, come and go, and we're very mindful that at this point we're looking at doing Lakeshore, say next year. It's really a financial constraint and a capacity issue to not do three major projects all in 1 year. So in looking towards that, we at this point have left $500,000 in the federal gas tax fund. However, I would hate to see us take Brown Street and create more work, impact to our taxpayer, and add $30,000 in cost, I think it would make much more sense for us to use more of the federal gas tax funds, continue with the project, but it will mean that we'll have less funds to be able to do Lakeshore or whatever priorities come forward next year. But I still think that's a better use of funds than taking on additional costs in order to delay a project over 2 years. So I do just before we
sense.
Just before we depart.
Yeah, that makes done. Sense, and we can certainly take that into account. And it's we want to minimize the. I mean, we want to come in and around it. If we could come in under 2%, we would be happy. But as you can see, our requirements just built up a little bit more with donations. We'll get there. And as I say, somebody may find some money and they're operating. Okay. Any further questions for tonight? And I Councilor?
With the new laws and the changes coming under the new Marijuana Act and stuff, has any thought been given into how much the municipality may take in on tax money from that, or is that something we're going to have to wait a year, 2 years down the road to see how it plays out?
Well, the Ontario government gets the first $100 million profit, and then the municipalities split 50-50 thereafter, so we have no idea.
God, if we get through a year, there's no real...
Yeah, we won't know for a good year.
...judging on what it would do for tax take down the road.
Right. Yeah. So, and I understand Shoppers has been an approved dispensing point, which is good because they dispense drugs now.
Just on that point, if I could, Mr. Chair, at the next Committee of the Whole meeting, December 18th, committee will be presented with a report regarding whether or not the municipality wishes to opt in or out of marijuana sales, cannabis storefronts in the municipality. So that will ultimately determine whether or not we see any development in that area. But at the current moment, we don't have any requests or any sort of inkling that those requests are imminent.
Further than that, because of the revenues unknown, I don't think we're, as a municipality, we've got into licensing, an establishment like that. And I think some municipalities are looking at licensing and maybe having some sort of revenue from it. So have to be opt in or out. Though I'd like to at least look at what some of the communities have done with respect to potential licensing to help manage it.
So that point, the municipality doesn't currently license businesses. That would be an element of existing business licensing, and you would be prohibited from, additionally taxing a marijuana facility more so than any other business through your licensing program. That would be punitive, and that wouldn't be allowed. But to that point, the municipality doesn't currently license businesses, so there really wouldn't be a revenue stream to gain from that element unless you're taking a look at a wholesome approach to businesses in the municipality.
Thank you. Any further questions or discussion from council? We need a motion to recess. Can I get somebody to make that motion? Mayor Sanderson, seconded by Councilor Meadows. So you began the meeting and you ended the meeting. You're wonderful. Okay, all in favor? Thank you. We are recessed. Thank you.